Also, now Father Blaise will join.
Yes, ma'am.
Also, now only 89 are there, no, in the meeting.
Yes, ma'am. Actually, I add 90, but then maybe someone gets disconnected. Okay. But I'll keep on keep the count at 90.
Okay. Father Blaze is not from, no?
No, no. I can't see Father in waiting room.
Alsona.
Yes, ma'am.
Father Blaze just called. He's saying that he's not able to get in. So I told him to try again.
Ma'am, I'll have to remove someone from waiting room. Only then Father will be able to
then
join.
Then please remove, no? Yeah, please.
I remove now. Then tell now only Father to join.
Yeah, I told him just remove.
Okay.
Okay.
Ma'am, now there's place in waiting room.
Yeah. can't see him, but
no, not yet joined.
I'm also removing.
Yeah, father is there.
You got him?
Yes, got him. I've admitted.
Good evening, Father Blaze.
Good evening.
Good evening, Father.
Good evening. Yes.
Father, I can't see you.
You can't see me. You should be able to see me.
Yeah, now I can see.
So 2 minutes more and we can start.
Vinny, why have you not changed my profile picture?
Huh? Okay, Father, I'll change it next time.
I have got one with my clerical suit. I prefer that.
Yes, Father. Father, I will take it from you.
Beside the bust of St. Ignatius.
Okay, Father. I'll take it. Yes.
This one, my head, I don't like the head, my face cut or haircut.
Okay, Father.
Yes, okay. Dr. Kagan, I think, is trying to wish me. Yes.
Yes, sir. Namaskar, sir.
Namaskar.
How are you, sir? I hope Mumbai is pleasant now.
Mumbai, no, it's warm. Bahut garam ho raha
hai. I see.
Okay.
But Delhi is relatively pleasant.
Okay. Nahin, yahan toh bahut garam ho raha hai. It is rather warm.
But the corona cases have increased sharply in Mumbai.
Yes. So I took my vaccine on Monday.
I see. Okay. So late?
So late means they gave me date. I got quickly. I finished also in 5-10 minutes.
Yes. That's. I also got it on 22nd of March. Me and my wife both. So we could get it because we got a comorbid. But we went to the government hospital rather than the private hospital. But it was very smooth, even in the government dispensary, small village dispensary. It was very smoothly done.
Yes.
Sir, can we begin now?
I also took on 22nd only.
Oh, I see. So.
Yeah, yes. Monday afternoon.
So which one you had, Covaxin or Covishield?
Covishield.
That's better. Now, for the second dose, go after 2.5 months, not between 6 and 8 months.
Yes.
Not before 2.5 months. Though the government is saying that 6 and 8 weeks, between 6 and 8 weeks, but it is advisable to go after 2.5 months. I will go after only after 2.5 months.
Yeah, okay. I will see.
This is what the creator of this vaccine are saying.
Okay. Anyway, for the moment, I have been quite okay. No problem at all.
Yes, sir.
It's already 4 o'clock. So, good afternoon, participants, and welcome to the webinar series 9 of the mathematics webinar series, Strategies and Solutions for Boosting Mathematics Learning. I would, at the outset, request our principal, Dr. Susama Samuel, to start with a few words.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yeah. So on behalf of St. Xavier's Institute of Education, I welcome you all to this webinar series on mathematics, on the topic strategies and solutions for boosting mathematics learning. It is an initiative of our mathematics pedagogy unit, which is headed by Dr. Vinny Sebastian, and the mathematics pedagogy unit students. And this is the ninth webinar series on this topic. And the past sessions dealt with the various pedagogies of mathematics teaching. And some were the innovations, some were dealt with the innovations of mathematics. Some of them were like, sharing the research findings. And mostly the past sessions dealt with innovative pedagogies in mathematics. And the purpose or the goal of this webinar is to boost mathematics, or we can say to improve mathematics education. And especially we know that the student community, they have a phobia towards mathematics, and also teaching community also to develop interest in students. So overall, the purpose of this webinar series was to improve overall mathematics teaching, and to develop interest in teaching as well as interest in learning mathematics. Like our past sessions, I said the past 8 sessions, and the brochure says that this is the 9th session in this webinar series, and it is a free webinar. And this past sessions, we had our resource persons from various institutes, premier institute from India. Some of them, our session was from NCERT itself. And also we had a resource person from Homi Bhabha Center for Science Education, and some were from international schools, IIT, and also professors from B.Ed. College, etc. And today's topic for this session is that is something different from the previous ones, that is talking science to mathematics teachers by our eminent resource person from NCERT, Dr. Gagan Gupta. So Dr. Gupta sir is a very popular personality in the internet also. We can see sir's videos, we can see live sessions of sir, and also we can see some of the sessions he has conducted for the students also, how to prepare the students for the examination. So sir is a very popular person in the internet, giving sessions on education, especially on maths and science education, because sir's the background of sir is, I think, science and mathematics education, and he is the right person today to talk on, and he's going to talk on talking science to mathematics teachers. So I think the title itself says that talking science means that it shows that the importance of the science in mathematics, or I presume maybe the relation sir is going to talk between the relation between the science and mathematics, or the close bond between the science and mathematics. So whatever it is, sir is the right person to talk today on what is the importance of science in mathematics. And we know that mathematics is the language of science education, and we know that science education provides a framework for mathematics. So in this relation, maybe sir is keeping this relationship in mind. He is going to speak to us on what is the importance of science in mathematics, and he is the right person definitely to speak on this topic. So on behalf of the college, Father Blaise D'Souza, our manager, and all participants, I welcome our resource person to this webinar, and also I welcome all participants to this webinar. So before closing my words, I would like to appreciate the effort of our mathematics pedagogy unit, Dr. Vinny Sebastian, and the students. She started this webinar during this pandemic, but after that it is diversified. I can definitely say that also along with this webinar, she has switched over to research also. In every month, the unit had taken up different topics to conduct research, and the research findings also shared with the participants. So from one step ahead, I think every month we are moving one step ahead in this webinar itself, in mathematics teaching as well as in the research, which is useful for learning mathematics, and also to reduce this phobia and to create interest in mathematics. So my all praise and congratulations to mathematics unit, and also Dr. Vinny Sebastian. So once again, I welcome all participants, and also our today's resource person, Dr. Gagan Gupta, and all participants to this webinar. Thank you. Over to Dr. Vinny Sebastian.
Thank you, ma'am, for those motivating words. So as a mathematics pedagogy unit in charge, and also leading this mathematics webinar, I was sitting here and thinking about the time when we started off with this webinar with lot of uncertainties in mind, and thinking whether this webinar is going to be of any help or how is it going to be. But we started with a good cause, and our main intention was, as ma'am said, to bring about some change in the mathematics teaching learning, especially at the school level and at the junior college level, as B.Ed. is catering to these levels. And the thought came to my mind because the school teachers and the junior college teachers are very, very busy catering to students, and they hardly have touch with experts in that particular subject. So we have given an opportunity to the teachers to get in touch with the experts in mathematics. And definitely it has been of great help to the teachers. And every time when I read the feedback form, we get motivated enough to continue with this webinar. And a lot of appreciation has come from a lot of participants. Many participants register for the webinar from different parts of the country. And seeing that also, we were motivated to continue with this work. Although it was really difficult to continue every month, we kept up our motivation. And even when we were going along, some of the science teachers also said that, why don't you have this in science? So I think today's webinar is a very good webinar where we are linking science and maths. Because sir was very highly motivated, and he said that, madam, you know that how much of maths we are using in science. So there should be a webinar in this so that the teachers are aware that how much of maths is used in science. Also, I believe that the performance of students in science is affected if they are not good in mathematics, if they do not practice mathematics. Because we see that there are problems in science also, and students, they run away from those problems because they think that there is so much of maths in that. And even the understanding of science concepts requires a lot of mathematics. So I'm so happy that we have Dr. Gagan Gupta with us, and he's working in the NCERT, and the NCERT is a body that gives us direction, especially for school education. And definitely his talk will be of great help to all of us, B.Ed. teachers as well as school teachers, and how we should be moving in this direction, and how we need to motivate our students for mathematics as well as for science. Definitely all this effort is not a single person's effort. We have our Father Blaze, our manager, who gives us the direction every time. And we have our very own principal, Dr. Sosama Samuel, who is our motivating force. In fact, both of them have added this dimension into our mathematics webinar, where we conduct the small researches, and they always try to push and say that, what more are you doing, and what is it that you're achieving from this webinar? So definitely this, the small researches that we do is also of great help to us. It has been a learning experience for all of us. Today we will be presenting a study on critical thinking in mathematics, and every research has been a very good learning experience and a good insight. So more than even from the webinar we learn, and even from the research we conduct, we have learned a lot. And all this is not possible without the effort of our student body, and the students have been a great help, and each and every resource person has appreciated our students so much, and they say that our students are very, very responsible, and they do the task so diligently. And I want to appreciate our student team, Alsona, Clarice, Riesel, Nisha, Rachel, Vaseem, and Daya, who have constantly been with me all throughout these webinars and have been motivating me and doing all the tasks behind the scene. So thank you everyone. And now we will start with the session. And I invite Clarice to introduce our resource person for the day.
Good afternoon to one and all present here. Very fortunate to introduce our resource person for the day, Dr. Gagan Gupta. Sir is currently an associate professor in physics in the Department of Education in Science and Mathematics, National Council of Education, Research and Training, New Delhi. Dr. Gupta completed his PhD from Aligarh Muslim University, Aligarh. Dr. Gupta has served as a faculty member in several institutions, including the Aditya Birla Institute of Technology and Science, Pilani, and the Birla Institute of Technology, Mesra Ranchi. Sir has published several research articles and monographs and has also participated in several national and international conferences in India and abroad. Sir's research work lies in the area of development of new lasers and application of lasers in underwater acoustics. Dr. Gupta has also developed a prototype experiment for studying the characteristics of laser-excited underwater sonic waves and has several new undergraduate experiments in physics and material science. An experimentalist in children assessment procedure, Dr. Gupta is presently involved in the curricular development, textbook development, and science popularization programs of the NCERT. Sir has coordinated and authored the development of various textbooks in science and physics in Hindi and English versions. Dr. Gupta has also been associated with various national and international bodies of academic endeavors. Words and time may fall short to acknowledge the incredible work Sir has done. We are pleased and grateful to have you with us today. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Clarice. And we have Alsona and Riesel who will be taking up questions during the session. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Father Blaise, Principal Saiba Samuel ji, Dr. Samuel, Dr. Vinny Sebastian, and young students of St. Xavier's Institute of Education. It's indeed a matter of great privilege for me in being with you again, once again. A few months ago, I was a part of one of your webinar, which was done in relation with the National Education Policy. And today I am on scholastic discussion, having interaction with science and mathematics. I am a student of physics, and yes, do understand the need of kind of mathematics which a science student need to do. My concern today is to combine the two subjects together to see so that the synergy between the two subjects takes place in a more efficient manner. There are some discrepancies, there are some misnomers handling in both the sides, in science as well as in teaching in science, as well as in the teaching of mathematics. So today, my appeal is to the mathematics teachers to be little sensitive about their about the mathematical concepts and their uses in their scientific arena as well as in their everyday life. I start with, can I share my screen? So, friends, I would like to request, if you can listen to me, I would like to request to keep on asking your questions. My presentation is not a very coherent one today. It's scattered, touching points from one dimension to another dimension. Yes, having realized that mathematics is the first thing which a child learns. Mathematics is natural. I will touching all these points. Science is not natural. Science is the study of nature. And science, the best definition of science, which I can say, is the quest for understanding nature. So by definition, the study of science is man-made. Yes, nature is not complex. Nature is simple, but the study of nature is complex. And that comes with science. Though mathematics is very natural, very inherent in nature. Many a times, see, mathematics has been far ahead than the development in science. The kind of mathematics which was developed nearly two centuries ago, or two and a half centuries ago, is now being used by scientists in the form of numerical analysis. All formulations of Newton-Raphson method, Runge-Kutta methods, or Euler methods, numerical methods came somewhere in the end of 18th century, and which we could start using efficiently only after we got the electronic computers somewhere around 1960s or 1970s. Now with the advent of so-called parallel processing, these are not parallel processor, of course, but the fast computers, the utility of these numerical methods is increasing in mathematical modeling, and particularly we are seeing in the case of meteorological applications where we are able to predict the weather to a good approximation, to a good extent. This is because of the use of mathematical applications, mathematical numerical analysis techniques with the use of fast computers, supercomputers. So today I would like to continue with this. Let me share my screen. I hope you can see it. Let me make it
full screen.
Yes, sir.
Let me make it full screen. It has not yet come. Yes, now it is. This slide gives my coordinates to you. I am a student of physics and work with the Department of Education in Science and Mathematics at National Council of Educational Research and Training. My email IDs are given here. My telephone number is also given. I would request and suggest if you get questions, even after this today's discussion, you can always email me. And friends, the students' emails and the emails of my friends have made me to learn much more. And your emails, your questions have helped me in developing these kind of interactive lectures, with this kind of lectures throughout. So I welcome your emails. I may be late in answering the questions, but I will definitely acknowledge the delay in answering your questions is mainly because that I do not know the answers. Many questions I do not know the answers, and probably that is the key of development. And through those such kind of questions, I could learn better. I could learn much many more things. I remember one child had asked me a question a few years ago through a video conferencing program, nearly 15 years ago. That on what basis the question was, I am just putting two questions to all of you, those are not only from mathematics, but they involve a lot of mathematics and pattern recognition. Those questions were, number one, then on what basis do you say that life exists only on planet Earth? And number two, the second question was, it was asked by a child from Ghana, that Dr. Gupta, what do you think, can a human being ever be superseded by a robot? Probably the children were seeing the movies like Robo, which we have seen in our country by Rajinikanth's movie, a kind of movie which we saw the utility of robots, which were having, which had developed the emotions as well. But anyway, that was a movie. But the child question, and I still do not have the answer of these two questions, even after 15 years. But today, after 3-4 years, I could find out that why do I not have the answers of these questions, which we can discuss in today, slightly later. So friends, this I just told you to express that I may not be able to answer your questions immediately, but I will definitely acknowledge, and we will try to find the answers of your questions together in due course of time. So first I will show you that how science works. This is a slide, which is, I hope all of you can track with me through your chat box. Anyone can recognize this slide? This was very popular on WhatsApp and Facebook a few years ago. I have taken it from Facebook with permission, sir. Of course, with permission, yes. Hello, yes, somebody was saying something. Yes, please. Yes, please. Can anybody recognize this slide? What is it? We often say that science develops through observations. science is merely and solely through all laws of science are empirical. Means what I am saying that all laws of science have been observed or being framed on the basis of experimental observations. Every philosophy, every idea in science is subject to experiment. It takes millions and millions of experiments and observations to make a law or to reach to a principle. But the single experiment is sufficient to disobey or to disprove or to nullify the principle or theory. Yes, this dynamics has always been there. The laws of science are dynamic. For nearly 400 years ago, we used to consider that the earth is flat and this is the sun which revolves around the earth. 400 years ago, Galileo had shown some observations and shown and verified that no, it's not the sun which is revolving around the earth, it's the earth which is revolving around the sun. So heliocentric model came in. That before we were having the geocentric model of solar system. So the whole philosophy kept on changing. Similarly, nearly 120 years ago, we were saying that mass is invariant quantity, means mass remains constant. But with the development of Einstein's theory, the most famous equation, E is equal to mc square, is many of us and large population of the world considers the most famous equation ever is E is equal to mc square. But with this coming, I will come back to this equation again. The intricacies of this. Yes. Yes, please. So that equation is most famous equation. With that, we learned that mass is not constant, mass is not invariant, but there is the mass can change into energy. That we have seen. It's now thinking that the energy can be changed into mass, which is given by the standard model and the string theory model. So, but still we have to verify it. But I ask you another question now at this moment, that all textbooks say that Earth is spherical in nature, Sun is much farther, and Sun is much bigger, and the Moon is much smaller than the Sun in size, and Moon is much closer. This all textbooks say. But let us think about it. Do we ever do any activity, or does a child ever realize this? Because of what we see in the sky every day, that probably the Moon and Sun are of the same size and at the same distance. There is no intuition, or there is no understanding to a child that can make a child to understand that that Sun is much farther and Sun is much bigger than the Moon. Here I give this activity. This we can do. This picture where you are seeing the Moon, I think that all of you can see the mouse button, the arrow button.
Yes, sir, we can see.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this picture has been taken at North Pole. This is a true picture. There is no Photoshop work has been done. So this is the lake on the North Pole, and this is the Moon, and this is the Sun. Here you see the reflections of the Sun and Moon on this in the lake. Forget about these reflections, but what you are seeing here, that here the size of the Moon is much more than the size of the Sun, isn't it? But what do we see in India anywhere? If I see in this globe, if you are here or here or here, somewhere anywhere, you see almost the same size, but can I make you to recall that some pictures which we have been seeing in recently in the WhatsApp, which have been circulating, the pictures were from Norway, where the size of the moon appears to be much bigger than what we see the size of the moon here. We remember that there are some roads, and it is being said that as if the road, the moon size is so bigger that as if the moon road is approaching to the moon. So those were, I'm not giving those pictures here, but because those the permission I could not get for those pictures. But those are the two pictures yet again. If you see in the Norway, which is closer to the North Pole, if you see, so the, I mean, what I mean to say that the observations here in this belt or here are different from the observations what we see at Norway or at North Pole. So that observation, see what science says, that the observation, the laws of science remain the same, where whether you do it today or tomorrow, whether you do it or I do it or somebody else does it, or whether these are being done at one place or the another, wherever you do this experiment, any experiment, the results must be same. The results must be concurrent, same with all these things. But now in this case, it's not happening. Now let me take this to another, your everyday life experience. See, friends, now here you see two buildings. Now here I am using mathematics, some simple mathematical principles to make us to understand that yes, the moon is much closer to us and sun is much bigger than the moon. Suppose the child is here and here it is a smaller building and here you have a taller, much taller building. Now, if you see here, if a child is here, now if the child looks at the top of the two buildings, now this is for this building and this ray is for the taller building. Now, if I ask you that to this child, which building will seem taller? You'll say that this building will, the smaller building will seem to be taller to this child while he's here, because this, the angle of elevations, basically these are three-dimensional angles. I am not talking about three-dimensional solid angles at this moment. So I'm reducing the problem to the two-dimensional angles, the angles between two dimensions, between two lines, as an angle of elevation. I'm just reducing the problem at this moment. However, the true picture will come through the solid angles, the three, the cone angles which the building makes to the eye of the viewer. But let me just put it, since this angle alpha 1, alpha is much, much bigger than this angle beta. So since the angle alpha is much bigger than angle beta, so the tan alpha is bigger than tan beta. So we know that this building will appear taller than this building. But actually, this building is taller. This we know if we see it from outside. Now, if, suppose this child goes slightly backwards, and if he sees at this point where the top of the two buildings are to be are observed at the same elevation angle, the same angle. So, if he sees the two buildings here, the child will find that two buildings are probably of the same height, isn't it? Same height. Now, what if the child goes further behind? If you go further behind, then the situation will differ. Means now this building will, the taller building will actually appear taller than the smaller building. Now compare these results. These are the results which you see every day in your life. These are the scenes, these are the things which you see every day in your life. So while dealing with that simple trigonometric relationships, tan and tangent of angles, what we see, and the three-dimensional angle, which will come little later, not in my program, not in my schedule, but they come little later in our studies, probably at class 12th or undergraduate level, we see the rigorous mathematics of the solid angle at undergraduate programs. But I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about discussing these points even at very smaller levels, maybe at middle level or secondary level. There we cannot talk about tangents, but yes, we can talk about angles or the elevations. Now relate. Now try to relate these pictures. Now you are here in this belt, throughout. You will see that moon and sun both appear same, of the almost of the same size. You can't really distinguish it with them. Now, if you mix with this observation, with the observation of at North Pole, say, then you will find that moon size appears much bigger than the sun size. Though the sun appears to be almost of the same size as we see in the belt which we have around India or, Europe, America, etc., everywhere. What does that mean? If you compare all these observations, what does that mean? It means that the North Pole is that when you are reaching to the North Pole, you are actually coming closer to the moon and you are still farther from the sun, as you have seen in this diagram. If you are closer to this smaller building will appear taller and taller. While if you are farther, the smaller building will also appear small. So now, with this example, with this correlation of these observations, which is nothing but simple patterns, which is simple mathematics, you can argue that the moon is much bigger, much smaller in size than the sun, because the sun size, the size of the sun doesn't change. The size of the moon changes. It means sun is much farther. Sun is much, much farther than us. And since the sun is appearing as the size of the moon, it means that actually the sun must be much, much bigger than the size of the moon. And thirdly, at the same time, you are able to argue, you are able to understand that the surface of the earth is not flat. Because while you are around in India or in this belt, while you are in this belt here, you are farther than the moon, farther from the moon than you are at the North Pole. So this shows that the surface of the earth is not flat, but it's curved. At least you can see that, at least you can have some appreciation at that stage, class 6, 7th, 8th, or even little earlier, or even at 9, 10, 10th, where children are not having any galactical understanding or any astronomical understanding to understand that moon is closer and sun is farther. So this makes a child to have little more understanding how science works, how the formulation of the, how the laws of science are being framed. How do we reach to the formulation of principles of understanding the things around us in science? In case if you have any question, we can have a small discussion point at this time. Any question? I am stopping sharing my screen for the moment, and then we can have some questions ahead. Yes, I hope you can see me, and then please ask questions if you have.
Yeah, also now, Riesel, any questions, then you can bring it up now.
Ma'am, we have questions, but those are very general questions, not related to what sir has explained.
Anyway, you can speak to me so that at least those who have raised the questions, we can involve them right now.
Okay, sir. So one of the question is like, how can we motivate the children for doing mathematics?
All right. Okay. When you see the applications of mathematics in their everyday life, the children will automatically be motivated towards learning mathematics. See, you need not to do much for motivating children for doing mathematics. They do mathematics. Mathematics is the first thing which child learns. Mathematics is definitely the first thing. Many people argue that children mathematics is so inherent that even a child learns before the birth. I do not understand that much, but I can argue that the children mathematics is the first thing which child learns first after the birth. The argument before it is that how does a child recognize his or her mother after the birth? Through sungne ke saath, they just smell it. Child being in the stomach of the mother understands the smell of his or her mother. So as soon as he comes out, he doesn't listen, he cannot see, the child cannot listen, the child cannot see at this moment, but still can recognize mother. How? The smell. It means that the children are very much natural to classify the things, to recognize the patterns. And this pattern recognition or the classifying of things is nothing but simple mathematics. Friends, mathematics is not just the numbers. Mathematics is natural, mathematics is the livelihood. Means every step you do mathematics, each and every step you do mathematics. So, and when you, what I can speak to my mathematics colleagues, that try to relate the mathematical formulations with the everyday life, and children will be motivated automatically without having said that we are motivating you. So without making any extra effort for motivating them, please just, my message is just to imbibe your mathematical results with the everyday life, and that is sufficient to my understanding. I hope that I have been able to give some justification to the question, Rizal.
Yes, sir, definitely. Sir, so there's one more question on Zoom. Are there activities which can be conducted during classes which are based on physics as well as mathematics?
Yes, sure. I will do that. I will, please wait for some time. I have some in my bouquet. I have
okay,
some.
Sir.
Okay. So if there is nothing, so shall I go to my screen share again?
Yes, sir, yes.
Okay. Now, see, this is another activity. Here, let me see. Science talks about the shapes of understanding the bodies. How do you conclude about, how do you get the information about the bodies, about the objects, whether these are celestial objects or these are, on the planet Earth or on your planetary objects, wherever you are. Science talks about this. Science definitely talks about it. So this is an activity which tells you how you can make decisions, how you can read decisions about the shapes. Now suppose this is a cylinder, okay, and you can't see, you do not know anything what it is. You do not know, you absolutely don't know. This is something like black box to you. And if you throw the light from this side, if you throw the light to it, it appears to be a circle. Means the transverse section of this, the shadow comes out to be circle. So you have a understanding that this object has a circular part. Right? But at the same time, if you are throwing the light from this side, and if you get another circle here, and similarly, if you throw the light on all sides of this, on this object, and you get cylinder, circles on all the sides of this walls, then you can conclude that it means that this object is spherical in nature, right? But now in this case, where I have brought a cylinder, now if you throw the light from this side, then the shadow here will be rectangular. So it means that one of the section of this object is circular, and another section is rectangular. Now, if you combine the two shapes together, you can very easily reach to this conclusion that this object is cylindrical in nature. And this is how we make observations and we decide on the objects through the signals from them, from those objects, to decide that how they are. So the how they are, this is how we make decisions. So this is an activity of having understanding of geometrical shapes. This is a part of that which we study in the part of mathematics. And yes, the understanding and the discovering the bodies, discovering the objects, discovering the information about the objects, which we largely study in physics. So this is probably will give the answer of the second question, Rizal, I believe. And we can have many more activities of the same kind. So this is a simple, are you seeing that the integration of mathematics, how in mathematics understanding is helping us to draw conclusions in science, to formulate scientific laws. I hope you are appreciating it. Now, if you see this diagram, for example, see, I'm talking about how do you observe these? These are all very famous, popular diagrams which I have brought to you. There's nothing which is, I have taken many of these diagrams from Facebook or from Twitter or from other sources, from internet sources, with permission, of course. Now, if you see that in this diagram, look at the middle one. Look at the middle circle. If I ask you inherently that which circle is bigger in size, you may attempt to say that probably this circle is bigger in size as compared to this. But if you see it, if you concentrate a little more, then you will find both the inner circles are equal in size. But still, what is appearing? That this circle is appearing much bigger than this side, this circle. Just because when you see it, it's in relation with, in concurrence with the, or in relation with the objects in its surroundings. So here you have smaller circles beside it. So you have a tendency to understand this to be bigger. And here, the since the surrounding circles are much bigger than this circle in question, so this circle appears to be some smaller in size. So this is how the optical illusions are being formed. I'll give you an example of this in due course of time. Just wait for some time. So this is how, I mean, what I'm trying to say, that all observations are relative. All observations are relative in nature. Nothing in science, there's nothing is which is immortal. There's nothing which is fixed. There's nothing is inherent. I mean, everything is relative. Every observation is relative. The line is big. A line is big. It has no meaning until unless we say that this line is bigger in comparison to another line. Now, let me come to the understanding of science once again. Euclidean geometry, within the area of Euclidean, the child doesn't have any idea of geometrical domains. Rather than giving the names of the geometrical domains first, we can have the discussion through limitations. How do we define a line segment? In Euclidean geometry or in class secondary, we define the line segment as that if we extend the two ends of a line segments, they will never meet. Isn't it? Am I right? Rizal?
Yes, sir.
So this is how you define a line segment. That a line segment, let me repeat, how do we define the line segment? That when you extend the two lines, suppose here you have a line segment and you extend the two line segments in opposite directions, the two extensions will never meet. Isn't it? Right? Am I right? Please interact.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now look at the situation. Now draw a line on your floor. Now draw a line segment on your floor. Now keep on extending the two ends. They will move you will move according to the curvature or the earth, curvature of the earth. So if you are able to extend the two lines, the two ends of the line segment over the whole surface of the earth, you will see that the two ends meet. Isn't it? Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Now, what is happening to your definition of a line segment? You started with a line segment whose definition is that when you extend the two ends of the line, they will never meet. But now if you are drawing a line segment on the planet Earth, on the roof, or on the floor, wherever, and if you keep extending it, you will find that as if the line is extending, that the two ends are meeting. Now here you get, what does that mean? Here you get that idea that if we say that a line segment is defined as when you extend the two ends of a line segment, they never meet. It is valid only for small portions, small geometrical objects. This is valid only on a smaller geometrical object. But if you do it on the larger bodies, larger sections, this doesn't hold good. So here you are able to differentiate, or you are able to bring the idea of two geometries called Euclidean geometry and Riemannian geometry. So here I have plotted this graph, brought this cup to you, which shows that if you are having a gun pointed on the body of the cylindrical cup, it seems that you are shooting into the gun itself. So if you go ahead, if you move with a single expectations, with the single results that of a line segment without having understood the limitations of those results, you are probably ending up with the phenomena like shooting into the gun. This cannot happen. So this kind of examples makes you to understand the limitations of the mathematical aspects of the mathematical formulations. Well, I hope that I have been able to give you some idea the domains of mathematical rules. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Are you enjoying? Shall I move ahead like this, or shall I change my strategy of dealing with you?
Go ahead, sir.
Yes, sir. Very well.
Go ahead.
Very good, sir. Go ahead.
Okay. So what I mean to say that all laws of mathematics, whether these are mathematics or all laws of, it's very difficult to have any universal law. So far, friends, let me tell you very honestly, so far, we have only one law of, which is universal in nature, which is considered to be universal in nature. And that is universal law of gravitation. There is no constant which is constant throughout the galaxy except the gravitation constant, capital G. However, there are some problems in that universal law of itself. Within the phenomena and anomera of some regions of planets and solar systems, we have some modifications to the universal law of gravitation. That is, the power 2 is changed by 2 plus epsilon. But that is, you know, that the force between two masses is given by F is equal to capital G, M1, M2 by R square. That is the inverse square law. But in the case of some astronomical domains, it changes to F is equal to G, that is the universal gravitational constant, M1, M2 divided by R raised to power 2 plus epsilon. But this epsilon is very small. There's no other constant in the history of science which is constant throughout the system, throughout the galaxy, whether it is the permittivity or permeability or whatsoever it is. No other constant. Even the atomic energy levels are not same. The same elements are not same throughout the galaxy. In fact, if we find any object here, how can we say that this object does not attain to the earth. This is being said by seeing their atomic structures, and we see that the atomic structures of the carbon-like material, carbon-like element, which we get on other surfaces, on other astronomical objects, are different. And so, however, on this planet, all carbon-like, all carbon elements, carbon molecules have same atomic structure. So this is how. Remember that all laws of science or all laws of mathematics, all geometric formulations are having their limitations. This example of shooting into the gun is for that. Now, I've been saying, Rezal, have you got some questions yet? Hello?
General questions, not related to what you were talking.
Anyway, you can go ahead. You can ask those questions. Let me stop sharing for a moment. And then.
Okay, sir. So one of the questions is on Zoom, and it is how to calculate interest in children for learning multiplication tables.
Okay, and then what is the second question?
And how is Vedic maths useful in today's life?
Okay, very short answers I would like to give to those two questions. Multiplication tables, there are many methods which are given in the textbooks using the household items like vegetables, like money which you have, and like many other examples which are given in the textbooks. You can use them. While I was a child, we learned it through the rote memorization. And I still remember the days, my school days, my primary school days, when we were made to stand in the prayer hall or in the prayer ground, and to rote the multiplication table 2 2 ja 1 2 2 ja 2 4 2 2 2 3 ja 6 and so far, so on. But a very good understanding to do it through the simple household items and simple calculations, simple through money or through some simple calculations. Then it is not necessary that a child of age of 6 learns the table of 16 or 17. Let the child learn only up to 5 or 6, and that's all at this time. So what was second question?
Sir, regarding Vedic maths.
Oh, Vedic maths. The Vedic maths has been very useful, and it was, and firstly, let me remind you, friends, that Vedic mathematics is just important, but this is not very old. The name Vedic is there, which makes us to understand, feel for a moment that as if it is coming from the Vedic era. No, it's recent. It's rather very recent. It's rather very, very recent. It's rather very, very recent phenomena. Vedic mathematics results are very alternate understandings. See, there may be many methods of understanding the same thing. However, it has been seen that there are limitations to Vedic mathematics to the simple arithmetic. If you do with the algebra, geometry, and to calculus, and which are required to understand scientific phenomena and to in other areas, the Vedic mathematics, the rule of mathematics rules are not either present there or are applicable there. Yes, Vedic mathematics is useful for making children interested in simple calculations, but the abstract nature and the intuitiveness can also be made familiar to the children at this stage with using the Vedic mathematics, but so as done by many other mathematical sources as well. But this is, please be clear that Vedic mathematics is not from the Vedic era. It's rather recent, for 200-300 years only, not much. It's not. So I hope, Rizal, I have been able to give some insight to that.
Yes.
However, these questions do not have single answers. There are many answers to that. Let me see in the chat box if there are some things. Not much. So is there anything from the YouTube yet?
On YouTube, there is one more question. It says, sometimes students ask that algebraic equation questions are not useful in future.
No. That's not true.
Yeah, so the algebraic question is equation, asking,
algebraic equations, you make simple mathematics, simple algebraic equations, like this, that, one has to differentiate algebra from arithmetic a little, and one has to appreciate algebra right in the beginning, in the form of arithmetical equations. For example, if somebody says that, if somebody says sir, that one bread piece comes in 2 rupees, so what is the price of 10 bread pieces? So this appears to the formulation, the finding the result is through arithmetic, but framing the problem is algebra. That if one bread piece is in 2 rupees, that 10 bread pieces in 2 into 10 is equal to 20. So doing 2 into 10 is arithmetic, but why to do 2 into 10 is algebra. So one has to make at the very early stage, one can tell them what to do is comes from our understanding in the algebra, and how to do that comes from arithmetic. So there has to be one little sensitive about the difference between the two and classification. However, it is not very important to tell that these two words separately, but the process of reaching to the answers has to be explained, and if it is explained properly, the children will enjoy algebra as well. See, it was, I tell you that Newton was basically a physicist, and he had to invent calculus because he was not able to explain the motion of celestial objects. So he had to find out some method to explain the things, and that is through algebra. Simple algebra was not found to be sufficient. So Newton has to invent calculus. So, and that's how the Newton is equally known as a mathematician, as a physicist. And many people say that he was more of a mathematician rather than a physicist. But nevertheless, as a student of physics, I find Newton that he had to invent calculus to find out, to solve the motion problems in physics, in physical arena, in everyday life. So connecting everything to the everyday life is the answer to this. Any other, is it okay? Rajal, can I move ahead?
Yes, sir, yes. You may continue your session. We will take questions later now.
Okay. No, I just took up the questions in the beginning so that people do not feel so bored. Anyway, and this is up to you, as you say.
So now, participants are enjoying your session. There is a lot of appreciation.
Okay, thank you very much. So now I was in the beginning itself, I was saying that the mathematics is natural, whereas science is man-made. Just let me explain it. See, mathematics, as I said in the example, very first example, that the child learns mathematics right from the birth. The first thing, mathematics is the first. And all laws of mathematics are based on some certain axioms and postulates. So this is why you are able to prove everything in mathematics. Particularly in geometry, hence prove, QED, Iti Siddham in Sanskrit, Siddhuwa in Hindi, what we call that, but that is related only in the case of mathematics, nowhere else. In science, for example, we form the laws, as I said that in the beginning, as I demonstrated that the moon is closer and sun is farther, and moon is smaller and much bigger in size. All these are the observations, all these are the laws of observations. Empirical laws. These are laws are empirical. So this, when we say empirical, and when we observe some particular events, and then we make some, find out some patterns in it, some correlation between these observations, and then we form a law. So using mathematics, we reach to a scientific law using patterns. Friends, let me just repeat what I said in the beginning also, that mathematics is not all about the numbers. Mathematics is about the patterns, classification, and understand. Mathematics gives you the capability of classifying the things. Mathematics gives you the capability of reasoning the things. Mathematics of gives you the capability of analyzing the things. So mathematics is not about the numbers. These numbers are just the representation of it. Representation of mathematical language, which is, so mathematics is the mother. Mathematics is everywhere. Is everywhere. All this reasoning, all this analyzing, everything is, this is everywhere. And so this mathematics gives you the power to understand everything, to understand or to analyze the things, whether you realize it or do not realize it. That's immaterial. But it's not very much concerned whether you realize it or do not, but it is mathematics. We do a lot of mathematics every day in our life. Every day we do a lot of, all of us do a lot of mathematics and everywhere, either in the form of geometry or in the form of abstraction nature of the mathematics or in the form of patterns or in the form of classifications or reasoning out or analyzing the things. We do. Now let me explain, this is the time to explain the three words which we see often see synonymously: science, engineering, and technology. Science gives you the basic laws, which are on the basis of some observations. The term engineering means using scientific laws, using laws of science, we can develop some mathematics or manipulate the scientific laws for the mankind. And technology is the product. For example, you take the case of centripetal and centrifugal forces. When you rotate the things, mv square by r, so the lighter particles moves out and the heavier particles remains inside. This is what you say, the when you go ahead with this understanding of centripetal and centrifugal force, and then using this principle, one has devised a washing machine. You must have seen a washing machine where you have a cylindrical rotor in it, and in which you just put the cloths inside with water and soap. So what soap does is that reduces the surface tension, the dust particles inside the cloths comes out, and when you rotate the whole rotor, then these particles comes out and moves towards outside. This is engineering. So this, they comes out and then they flush out from the pores of the rotor inside of the washing machine. And this is technology. The washing machine is the technology. Now, in this example, what I am saying, that science, today's science is giving you the birth to the tomorrow's technology. However, friends, be careful. It's not always true that today's science is going to give you tomorrow's technology. Historically also, during the Vedic time, if you see that the time, Rizal, probably you can, all of you can see me as well.
Together, yes, we can see you.
Okay. So probably, so my expressions are also there. Good. I was talking about the relation between science and technology. The relation between science and technology, yes, today's the technology came much before than the words, than the science came in. Remember, we were Homo erectus, see, from according to the Darwin theory, when we were developing from the gorillas to the man-made, and then we first learned the fire. When they put two bricks or the two stones together, and by the application of friction, they got some sparks, and that was the fire. And when we came into the Homo erectus series, then we started maintaining this fire and managing this fire. So remember, in this example, the fire is technology. Producing fire is technology. Okay, producing fire by the interference or by the friction between the two stones is technology. Then maintaining it is engineering. Keep some dry leaves there, keep some dry wooden pieces there so that this fire maintains, or keep some fuel with this ignition. It is engineering. But at the same time, understanding the utility of these materials and the friction, etc., is science. So in this case, technology has given the birth to the science. This is how the human evolution anthropologists understand it. If you see the anthropology, you will find many such examples of this kind. The most recent kind of example is that using science, we made optical microscopes. We made microscopes, and through this we could see what is there in the cell. Now, using this science, using this cell, we could make, and then came up the de Broglie wavelength theory, de Broglie wave particle dual theory, through using which we could make electron microscopes. And using these electron microscopes, we could see the atoms more clearly. And then, and seeing them more clearly made us to think about, develop the whole quantum mechanics in it. And then we could develop the tunneling electron microscopes in reflection and refraction both. And under seeing the images of this tunneling electronic, tunneling electron microscopes, we could learn more and more about the atomic structure. When we could learn more and more about the atomic structure, we could develop the quantum computers. We could see the quantum dots, etc. We could see that how electron behaves when it is in an electric field or in a magnetic field, etc., etc. So science gives birth to the technology, and as well as the technology also gives birth to the science. So friends, no, you do not prove anything in science. You merely verify them. When we do any experiment in science, that is not for proving any science, for proving any law. It's wrong to say that we have proven the Newton's first law. We have proven the Newton's second law. No, you can't prove them, because there is no meaning of proving them, because all these laws are empirical laws. These are not inherent. These are not immortal. These are not, these laws are experimental laws. So we merely verify them. In physics, there is only one law which we prove, that is the Pascal's law, which we see in the mechanics of fluids. But that is the law which we have borrowed from mathematics. That's not originally from physics. That is the law which we have borrowed from science, from mathematics. So friends, mathematics is natural, science is man-made, and so is engineering and technology. Next, see this, in order to see this, to substantiate or to argue that how natural science, mathematics is, which is not science, please try to read this. All these things you must have been doing, that you, yes, you, I am sure that you, all of you can read this paragraph correctly, but none of the spelling is correct. None of the spelling, very few spellings are correct. The only thing is that in this, the first letter and the last letters are their own place. And in between all words, all letters are jumbled, but you still, so how you are seeing it? How you are seeing it? How you are seeing this? How you are able to read this this paragraph? Because this is natural in number. So what is happening when you see a pattern? When you see a pattern of particular letters, though jumbled, but your brain corrects it on its own. Your brain does rest of the things, rest of the analysis that your brain does it. So human brain. Now I'm coming to the question that when I said that when a human being ever supersede a robot or not, or a robot can supersede a human being. I hope you can read it. So you are able to appreciate that science is, mathematics is natural. The whole paragraph is very much weird, but it is interesting, right? Now, okay, before I go for the next session, next portion, let me just stop by, and let me do one activity before you to understand that how it is natural. I hope all of you can see me.
Yes, sir, we can see you.
Okay, now please take a piece of paper along with you. Let us do one activity. Take a piece of paper, any piece of paper. Longer is better, but I will not be able to do it longer here. Let us do it with this smaller one. Make a cylinder like this. Please make a cylinder like this. Right, have you made? Can we start? Can we move ahead, Rizal?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay. Now close one of your eye. concentrate a little. Concentrate a little on the screen which you have in front. Now put this cylinder in front of your eye, in front of your second eye like this. You can see the screen through this hole, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay. Now remove your hand from the second eye like this. Now put this hand just beside this cylinder. Likewise, can you see me? Can you see my posture?
Yes, sir.
Can you see? Now just put yes, your sir. Hand like this. Just put your hand like this. Concentrate a little. Now what is happening? One of your eye is in front of the screen and another eye is in front of your palm. Now what you see? What are you seeing? You are seeing a beautiful thing. You are seeing that as if the hole has come to your palm and your palm has gone to the cylinder. In your cylinder, you are able to see your palm from the back side of your palm, and you can see the hole in your palm. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Both the things you can see together. You can see that as if the palm has entered into the cylinder, though it has not, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Are you seeing both the things together, that the palm is in your cylinder and there is a hole in your palm?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. It's beautiful.
Okay. Now let us think about this activity. Now, how your brain works. How your brain works. Let us talk about the phenomena that how your brain works. Well, when you look, suppose now if you see Gandhiji, namaskar. I can see you. Now, if you see, when you just see at the front using one of your eye, just make this exercise, please. Okay, and now look at the screen in front for a little. Now change the posture. I mean, close the first eye and look at the screen using your second eye. Do you see the two pictures exactly same? No, some slight changes. If you see the two images, the two scenes in relation with the surroundings, you will see them differently, right? Slight differences are there. How it is happening? It is happening as if that when the light rays are reaching to your eye, then your eye image forms on your retina. Image forms on your retina, that is inverted image, and the optical nerves behind your retina converts this optical signal into electrical signal. And this electrical signal reaches to your brain, which of course takes some time. And that gives birth to the reaction time. If time permits, I will talk a little more about that reaction time, or sometime later. We can talk about that phenomena. I am trying to understand your own body, our own body, and I am trying to understand the limitations of our own body. How it is. Simple mathematical patterns, and using it in science, the arena of science. Now, you have two eyes. The two eyes are apparently same, but not 100% same. Slight differences are there. So that the slight difference, there are slight differences in their retina. Now, when you see by one eye only, you see only one image, and only one kind of electrical signal reaches to your brain. And then the brain synthesizes, analyzes that signal, and makes us a feeling to see them, gives us the preservance or the feeling of seeing the objects. Now, when you do this exercise by your other eye, your another eye forms the retina on the other eye is slightly different from the other first eye. So slightly different images formed. Now the slightly different image is formed. So slightly different electrical signal is created by the optical nerves. And therefore the slightly different electrical signal reaches to your brain. So that you see the two images slightly differently. But now you are asked that if you open both the eyes, your common sense would say that now we should see some overlap in between the two images, but you do not see that. Now what happens? When the two eyes, two retinas, slightly different electrical signal reaches to your brain synthesizes them. Now your brain is something like computer, very fast computer. When it computes the two slightly different electrical signal, so the brain overlaps, brain concludes, or brain takes out the differences, the slight differences, and gives you the impression of only single object. Only single object. So though your two eyes are looking at two slightly different images, only two slightly different images are being formed on the two retinas. But when the two slightly signal reaches to your brain, the brain does the synthesis and analysis of it and gives you the impression of only one object, only one image, same. But now what happens when I use this cylinder? Now, through one eye, in the front of which you have this cylinder, looks at the screen in front through this small hole, right? So, whereas on the second eye was in front of the palm, the one eye was looking at the screen through the hole, and the second eye was centered on the palm. Now the two images which are formed on the retina are entirely different. Look, the two images are entirely different, friends. Therefore, the two electrical signals which are reaching to your brain are entirely different, right? Means now what happens, the brain gets confused. When the brain gets confused, it overlaps the two images. This is how your palm goes into the hole and hole comes to your palm. So this is how it is happening. So now, have you understood the limitation? That our limitation of, are you appreciating your own body? Our own body is behaving like that. Your own body is able to make some small corrections, but not able to make some larger corrections. So this is the limitation of our body. How we are reaching at it? Just by through mathematical expressions. Now, any question, please? So have you understood it?
Yes, sir, really interesting.
Somebody says that I can't see on my screen. Please repeat this experiment, or you can make those who are not yet able to see it can email me and then we can interact separately. We can interact separately on bigger screen sometime later. Well, let me move ahead. So what happens with this example? Understand this through this example, try to understand our own limitations. Now see, our brain is capable enough of making some small changes, of coping with some small changes. These robots are going to work with the computer, with the programs the human being have written. How many programs can you anticipate what is going to happen tomorrow morning to your shirt, which is hanging on the in your wardrobe? Or do you know that what exactly the shape of your slippers would be tomorrow morning when you are going to get up from the bed? Not 100%, not exactly. However, whenever you get up, even if the two slippers are lying differently, you are able to pick them up because of you have a very strong coprocessor in your mind, in your brain. So any creature made by your mind may not be many program with the making a pro, what I'm talking about, if I'm making a robot, and then the robot will work on the instructions given by the human being in the form of the computer programs. And how can you make the computer program for the incident, for the things which you do not know, which you can't anticipate? which you can't anticipate. So for the time being, it seems that probably no robot will be able to supersede human being. But at the same time, now friends, who you are talking of, we are discussing, we are giving this argument on the basis of the understanding what we have today. But who says that our understanding will remain the same today? As now the being coming up the era of artificial intelligence, we may exceed to the limits that these machines can have, can think of faster corrections than this human body. Remember, as far as the retrieval of data is concerned, these machines have already taken the goal from human beings. हम लोगों को याद नहीं रहता बहुत सारी चीजें, लेकिन मशीन को सब चीजें याद रहती हैं. यू कैन रिट्रीव द डाटा फ्रॉम एनी मशीन एट एनी टाइम एंड एग्जैक्टली द वे एंड प्रोबेबली थ्रू आवर मेमोरी वी आर नॉट एबल टू फाइंड आउट द डाटा. सो एज फार एज रिट्रीवल ऑफ डाटा इज कंसर्न, दीज मशीन्स हैव ऑलरेडी टेकन ओवर. सो टुमारो वी मे हैव आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस टू दैट एक्सटेंट दैट दिस कैरेक्टरिस्टिक ऑफ ह्यूमन ब्रेन दैट इट कैन मेक some small corrections on its own may also be taken up by robots or my machines. But at the same time, so my answer now is that I raise my hand that and saying this, that probably I am not intelligent enough to give the correct answer to it. It will all depend on the development of technological units and scientific eras, scientific systems through, of course, using the mathematics, all mathematical algorithms, etc. Now, if there is no particular question yet, I can share the screen. How much time I left with Viniji? Viniji?
I think around 15 minutes.
Okay, all right. So please make me to recall after 10 minutes, okay? Now, let me be particular that where I request our mathematics teachers about mathematics teaching through which we have to understand, we can understand science better. Now suppose there are two surfaces, one surface and another surface. I hope you can see the arrow moving around. Rizal, can we see the arrow?
Yes,
now this is one surface and this is another surface. Means this one surface and another surface, these are the two surfaces. Now if I ask you the simple question, that what is the angle between two surfaces, many of you will end up by saying this angle. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
But this is wrong answer. You know, this answer is wrong. The angle is a phenomena between two lines. These are two surfaces. These are two surfaces, friends. So angle is a phenomena between two lines, not between two surfaces, not between two-dimensional. Angle is a two-dimensional phenomena. Means some parameter between two single-dimension phenomena, architectures, means lines. Now what we do have to do, that you have to draw a normal here in order to understand this surface. This surface can be defined by a line. Okay, because surface area is a vector quantity. I will just discuss that how area is a vector quantity. Now this is a plane surface I am taking about. Okay, now so this is a normal and another normal on this. So that intersection of the two normals will give you the angle between the two surfaces. So I request mathematics teachers, geometry teachers in particular, or the vector teacher, the teachers, those who are teaching vector algebra, to be particular about these things. This is the mistake we science student always, I mean, often make. 90 to 95% times when we see, we interact with our science students, we find this problem. Moreover, remember, area is this vector quantity just because the pressure is a scalar quantity. When you define pressure as a force per unit area, force is a vector quantity. So, and now, but if you say, This is true for the plane surfaces, but a rigorous understanding of this will tell you that the whole area is a scalar quantity, but the aerial elements, the small aerial elements are the vector quantities. If you take the whole curved line, then you cannot define the area, direction of area. You can define the direction of area as a normal to the surface at a very small area where dx dy changes to zero. So, and this was the point where Newton has to devise, Newton has to invent calculus. Newton had to invent this calculus. This was the point to find the direction of area. This was the point. Now, let me, so this is the, so answer is so probably I will not go further much on this. I mean, not much time left. If anybody finds any problem in understanding it, we can have interaction through emails or we can have some other session some other time. But area is a vector, area as a whole is a scalar quantity, but the aerial element is a vector quantity. Area element, remember, area element, and this is where the application of calculus comes in. Other observations, see, okay, I will be a little selective. Now we say, friends, that I will be discussing the second point of this slide, that why more observations and how many observations. See, we see, if we do any experiment, suppose the pendulum experiment, what we do in our school laboratories, in class 10th, we say that, okay, repeat the experiment for 3 times and then take the mean or the average. In class 11th or 12th, we say the 5 times. And when we reach the MSc level, we see that the number of observations, error in the observations is inversely proportional, is proportional to the square root of that. If you take n observations, so the error will be under root n, square root of n, isn't it? All of you must have seen it in statistical mechanics or in the simple error analysis. So as increases under root n, decreases. But under root n does not increase the way n increases, the rate, the function delta under root n increases is much lesser than the function n increases. So this is how we say that. Now the question comes in, how many times? If we take an observation, if we see an observation, shall we have to repeat it 3 times, 5 times, 10 times, 100 times, 1 lakh times, 10 million times, 1 billion times, 10 billion times, trillion times, et cetera, and so forth, so long. How long? It means that you probably will never be able to get the correct value of or most accepted value of the observation. How do you control that? So at what level you can say that, okay, now it is sufficient, we need not to take any further reading. Any answer to it? Any answer? Okay, can give me through the chat box. I am seeing it chat box. Any answer to it, that how many observations? How many observations shall we have to take? Or as large as possible?
So minimum 2?
No. Two will not give that value.
Take the average of it.
No,
we
you take the average of
observation and then we take average of it.
No, for average of how many readings?
Any number of, to get a constant reading.
No, you can,
that will not. That's why we take many readings.
No, so when you will get the better result? The question is that, if that's what you say, that if you do 3 readings, you take 5 readings, you take 10 readings, you take 100 readings, you take 1 lakh readings. It is being said that larger the readings, better the answer.
It depends on the pilot reading and accordingly, then no. We proceed further.
No, my dear friend. It doesn't. You say n is... for
what is it, sir?
No. Okay, let me give you, let me tell you. Yeah, you see, statistics is the mother of everything. Even statistics is the mother of mathematics. Even statistics is more of observations. So as a student of science, I say that my observations, my studies are mostly statistical in nature and formulated with the mathematical rules, mathematical laws. But see, you take observations, you carry on taking observations. Suppose the pendulum experiment. So here on y-axis, I am having frequency, okay? And on x-axis, I am having values of any observations. So if I have to take the reading, suppose if I have to measure the length of a table, if I have to make a 1 meter table, if I use different scales, and different at different times by and taking observations taken by different people, you will find it somewhere, say, if the least count is 1 millimeter, then 1.001 to 1.002. Let us say that everybody is able to read it through least count. So the readings would depend from 0.999 to 1.001 meters, right? And so the uncertainty will be there. There will be an uncertainty in observation by 2 millimeters, that is 0.002 meters, right? Now, if you take the observations by 100 people, by 10,000 people, by 1 lakh people, 10 lakh people. So these readings will tend from 0.0999 to 1.001. Now, if you draw this diagram, you will find that slowly, you will find that the whole curve will become normal distribution curve. And once you receive this normal distribution curve, and if you are taking the larger number of readings, that has no meaning. So you have to take, the better result would come only up to when you are getting this larger, this normal distribution curve. So for any distribution, for any observations, for any kind of experimental observation, we take the normal distribution curve. If you plot the frequency versus value diagram for the same measurement, then, and if we reach to the normal distribution, the movement, if we reach to the 10, suppose in 100 readings, we get this normal distribution curve. Fine, there is no fun of taking 101 reading. And if we are not able to do that, if we are able to reach to this normal distribution curve after 10,000 readings, so there is no need of going further harder, but we have to reach, in order to reach the mean value, the corrected value, which will be the observed corrected value, will reach to us when we get the normal distribution curve. Only and only when we are confident that our reading is correct. And until unless we reach to this normal distribution curve, we can't commit that our readings are correct. Our observations are correct. So observations have to be analyzed in the sense when we reach to the normal distribution curve, which is also called as Gaussian distribution curve, right? Have you understood, friends?
But sir, there are also other curves.
No, but the other curves are there, Poisson distribution curves and distribution curves. Those are in different controlled systems. Those are not natural. Those are not in controls. So I'm talking about the uncontrolled curves. So those are for the different distributions, different kind of distributions which are under control. Those are not.
Okay.
Natural,
sir.
Is Gaussian. Gaussian, okay, is natural.
Okay, sir.
Haan ji, sir. So, sir. I hope you have understood that ki kitna reading lena chahiye. We take 3 readings, it is just an approximation. 5 readings, it is just another approximation. A better, slightly better. 100 readings, it's slightly, even slightly better. 10,000 readings, even slightly better. And so far, so on. But, and as soon as you reach to the normal distribution curve, stop taking further readings. So if you are able to get the normal distribution curve in n readings, then there is no need, the accuracy of n by 10 readings will be as that of accuracy of while taking by n readings only. So this is the whole. So I have 5 more minutes with me, or shall I? Otherwise, I can speak for hours together.
No, sir. So you can conclude it.
Okay, so this is all. Let me discuss it. Circle, but there are many more things, many more interesting things. Viniji, we can interact even after a few days in the next series of your death. I hope you will be finding circle versus cycle. This is a very circle is a geometrical shape, whereas friends, cycle is not a geometrical shape. Cycle is a concept that from any path, from whatever path you take, you reach to the initial value. That is a circle. That is a cycle. Circle, where the path is circle. So there are different words which are used in geometry or in mathematics or in English dictionary. They may appear synonymous sometimes, but all words have different meanings in some or the other context. So friends, at this point, I would stop. Okay, one more thing, which where we have, we make often mistakes. What is the value of this? Under root x square?
X.
plus minus x.
Wrong.
No.
It is always plus x. Though this has two roots, and these roots are plus x and minus x. But the definite, the mathematical rules are defined such that the under root, the square root of x square is always mod x. It's always plus positive quantity is mod x. So these are the So this is okay. There were so many others. Let me come to this point. One important point. Yes. As a student of mathematics, we make mistakes sometimes. If we are local in our thinking, what is A minus A? Please, any answer, please.
Zero.
Zero.
Zero. Always. This is true only and only with some constraints. This is not zero always. I have not spoken yet what is A. Remember, I have not yet spoken what is A. I have just given A is some variable. That's all.
A is positive, this is zero. Otherwise, it can be different.
If these are numbers, either it is say point minus one, if A is equal to minus one, so this will give you zero. So positive, negative will not make any difference. If these are numbers. Now let me put the another slide. See this slide. What is the value of this expression? Probably you will be better.
So zero?
No, beta, no. No, these are not definite integrals. So the first integral will give you minus cos x plus c. The sun, another will give you constant of integration t. So zero would be just one of the answer, but it can have infinite number of answers.
Yes, sir.
So means what I'm trying to say that A minus A is equal to zero only and only if these are numbers. But this expression is A minus A is equal to zero is not true for functions. If A is a function, then this expression is, then A minus A is not equal to zero. Okay, as you have understood that here, that sin x dx minus sin x x dx, it's not always equal to zero. If I put the conditions differently, in first integral, if I put zero to pi, and in second integral, if I put zero to pi by two, the answer will be different. So friends, boundary conditions, what I am saying, the boundary conditions are very important. And these are the boundary conditions which gives us birth the whole scientific arenas, the whole quantum mechanics, the whole apprehensions of quantum mechanics and high energy physics have come from boundary conditions. Whether you use annihilation operators, creator operators, you use the Heisenberg's uncertainty principles, you use any Schrodinger wave equation, the boundary conditions are very, very important. So I request my mathematics teachers to explain those phenomena. This is also an expression which I appeal to my mathematics teachers. They often use this expression as log x. No, it's not log x. The value of log means base 10. When we say log, it means it is an entity means base 10, but it is natural log x. So it is ln x, not log x. And this would take some more time to speak about it, that what is the meaning of these expressions. So I break my deliberation here, if you permit me, Viniji. And the rest of the things which are really very important for us can be discussed further in sessions coming on. I hope you enjoyed my discussion, my points here, my concerns here. Thank you very much. And I am now ready to take the questions.
Yes, thank you so much, sir. Yes, does anybody want to say anything? Sir, we have few questions which please. Are again general questions only.
Please.
So
I may not be able to answer all, but I will try with my best.
Okay, sir. So could you please suggest websites or resources which gives list of physics experiments that can be conducted in classes?
Very difficult question for me. I do not remember all these things. I have a very poor memory. Just Google it out, just for it. But some Fat Colorado or some our own NCERT's websites are giving some expressions, some correlations, and some. Just Google it out and have a vision. Have a, argue yourself with the correct test because the internet mein bahut kachra hai. Internet mein bahut kachra hai. So please be particular about the correct test. Otherwise, what happens? A wrong analogy can make a child's life havoc. So be particular about the correctness of the demonstrations which are given on the internet. I'm sorry, I can't give you the ready-made answer of it. I will have to Google it down. I really do not go with one website. I see many websites, and then I try to see each and every many videos or many expressions for analyzing them, and then I use or make some corrections to them. I'm sorry, yes, I can't give you any ready-made answer to it.
Yes, yes, okay, sir. One more question is, what are different strategies to teach mathematics for class 10th in online mode?
I am not very much in favor of this online classroom teaching at all, because the front, you can do experiments. Had you been in front of me today, probably I would have done slightly better. How do you feel? You please answer yourself. I have tried to do the some activities in front of you, but had you been in front of me, I would have done much more, many more, and more constructively, more understandingly. Anyway, but nevertheless, but what we can do that don't try to, my message to this online teaching is that don't try anything ambiguous. Be very particular. Be very, very particular. Explain only very well settled mechanisms, very well settled pedagogies. Don't try to be too much of innovative on this online mode, because children are not in front of you. And if they happen to get anything wrong with the wrong analogy or with the wrong expression, that will lead to a havoc thing. So please go only and only things which are very well settled. Don't try to be too much of over ambitious and to be over innovative in this. Don't be over ambitious. Do with the things which are very well settled. I hope this makes you to understand.
Yes, yes, sir, definitely.
Don't be over ambitious. This is what my message is.
Okay, yes. So one last question. How can we relate square and cube roots concept with real life?
A square root in geometry, you can do it. Area and side, area of the side, and then cube root, you can very do it with a vessel. With a vessel of a cube, I mean
volume.
You take a cube volume. Yes, you are right. Yes, you are right. Well, by volume, you can do it very easily.
Yes, so that's it, sir. Participants are appreciating your simple explanation and real life examples. Thank you so much for your amazing session. And with this,
thank
I
you very much for
the
listening
question
me.
And answer session.
Thank you very much for listening me. And anybody can ask and interact with me through emails, through telephone line sometime, but email will be better. And don't expect answer immediately. I'm a slow worker. I can take long time in answering, but I will definitely acknowledge the email.
Okay, thank you, sir, for your session. And I think, you know, it was so good that we just wanted to continue listening to you, but time is not on our side. And therefore, we thank you very much for all the effort that you've taken for today's session. And as I announced before, we had done a small research on perceptions of teachers with reference to critical thinking in mathematics. So I will request Nisha and Waseem to present the results of our study.
Yes, thank you, ma'am.
Nisha, can you start sharing the screen?
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, everyone. So as ma'am said, we conducted a survey last time on the perceptions on critical thinking in mathematics, teaching and learning. So let us understand what is critical thinking and their indicators. When mostly you can influence students in critical thinking by allowing them to make decisions. You can also encourage them to design their own questions in mathematics. We have to develop their information processing skills. We have to develop their skill of observation and data gathering. We should help students to apply problems to different situations. We should help students to discover, not just give them the fact, but let them come to that point. Engage them in divergent thinking. Engage them in this and collaborative learning. Engage them in reflection and self-evaluation, which is very important. Incorporate inductive deductive thinking and developing their mathematics vocabulary. Mathematics vocabulary, as we know, is very important. And lastly, internalizing mathematics formula. So let's move on to the questions that we had for our surveys and let's see the results. So our first question is, students are allowed to develop, one second, I can. Sorry, ma'am, I cannot see the screen clearly.
We can see, Nisha.
I'm actually not able to see the question because the head bar is coming down.
Okay. So should I read the questions for you?
Yeah, Vinny. Yeah, yes, Vinny. You, madam, you read, no, please.
Nisha, can I read the questions for you?
Yes ma'am.
Okay, so the first question is, students are allowed to develop decision-making skills while learning mathematics.
So we can see that we got 63 responses for this question and we can see that 55.6 people strongly agree to this, that students are allowed to develop decision-making when they are taught maths. Moreover, we can see that there are less number of people who disagree to this fact. Let's move on to the next question. Students are encouraged to make their own questions during the mathematics class. So for this, almost 42.9% agreed to this fact that they are allowed, whereas 17.5% disagree with this fact. So 17.5% teachers disagree with the fact that students are encouraged to make their own questions during mathematics class, which is sad. We should encourage them to make their own questions. Next question is, students are given opportunities to develop information processing skills in the mathematics class. So according to the survey result which we got, we get 49.2% who agree with this fact and 20.6 are neutral to this fact, whereas 25.4% people strongly agree to this fact. Next, teachers do not teach the skill of gathering information for a particular problem. Very sad to see that 74.6 people say it's very good that we do teach them the skill of gathering information. So 74.6% people thought that it is false. We do teach them the skill of gathering information. Next question is, Application of problems is left to the students while teachers teach the basic concepts in class. We can see the pie chart given here. 30.2 people disagree to this fact. So it's good because application to the problems, how the problems are applied in our daily life should be taught to the students. So, and 25.4 people agree to this fact. Next, it is difficult to use discovery learning in mathematics learning. 41.3 people disagree to this fact, which is very good because discovery learning is possible in mathematics learning. Divergent thinking cannot be encouraged in mathematics. 46% teachers believe that it can be encouraged, whereas 27% teachers are neutral to this fact. Debates in mathematics can help in encouraging creative thinking. 57.1 teachers agree to this fact, and whereas I also think that debates should be encouraged in mathematics, and this help them in creative thinking. Now I would like to pass it on to Waseem for the further questions.
Yes, thank you so much, Nisha. So our next question of survey is, collaborative learning is not a part of mathematics learning in schools and colleges. So here we can see that 42.9% disagree on this thought. So in most schools and colleges, we can see that collaborative learning is not part of mathematics learning. Next question. Students are not allowed to question teachers in class to clarify their individual doubts. So from this response, we can see that the students, we can see that 49.2% people disagree on this thought. So we can see that students are allowed to clarify their doubts in class itself. Next question. Student self-reflection and self-evaluation is not practiced in schools and colleges with reference to mathematics learning. So here you can see there is a divided opinion, but 39.7% people disagree, while 34.9% people agree on this. Next. Generalizations, laws, and principles are given to the students rather than allowing them to arrive at it. So here you can see most of the people agree on this. Usually what happens in schools and colleges, students are directly given the formula rather than making them derive it or understand it, understand the laws and principles. Next question. Teachers must put in more efforts to develop mathematics vocabulary and language in students. So here you can see majority of the people, that is 50.8% people agree on this, that the teacher should put more efforts in order to develop the mathematics vocabulary and language in students. Next question. According to you, do students experience the joy of getting solution to a problem in mathematics, or it is treated as a routine work? So here we can see that the majority of the people think that students feel accomplished when they find a solution to the problem. So 84.1% people agree on the thought that they experience the joy. They feel a self of accomplishment. Next question. Students are not given a chance to relook at problems and explain them once they are solved. So here you can see that 30.2% people agree on this, and 41.3% people disagree on this. That means students are given a chance to relook at the problems. Next. So rote memorization of the formula is encouraged in schools and colleges. So here you can see 73% people agree on this question. So that means rote memorization of the formula is encouraged in schools and colleges. Most of the teacher directly gives the formula for the topic without deriving it, and the students are told to write the formula 10 times, 20 times, and just memorize the formula from the point of view of examination. So we are done with the survey questions. Next slide. Nisha, yeah. So now we will see how to develop, there are some ways to develop critical thinking in students. So first of all, a teacher should present a solution with a flaw and ask the students to identify the flaw. Provide constant drill work with clear questions of increasing difficulty. After the teacher has explained the question, the teacher must give drill sums for the students to solve. Use analogies and open-ended questions. Use real-life problems. Students will understand mathematics well when it is related to real-life situations. Use more learning resources and games in mathematics. Use various theories of learning while teaching mathematics. Use mind map as a tool for critical thinking. Yes. Next slide. So the teacher must develop an open and free environment, learning environment, where the teacher should be approachable. The students should approach the teacher when they have any kind of doubts. Next slide. Now here you can see there are some skills to be developed for critical thinking. That is, the students must have observational skills, spatial skills, problem solving skill. This is the core skill of mathematics. Reflective skill, skill of analyzing situations, skill of presenting solutions to the problem. Thank you.
Thank you, Nisha and Vaseem, for presenting the study and the results of the study. I'm sure that the results will be of benefit to teachers. Kindly mute yourself, participants, kindly mute yourselves. Okay, so we are almost come to the end of the webinar series, and I would like to congratulate everybody for this webinar series and the students who have participated in this webinar. I thank all the participants also who have participated in this webinar series, and I am truly grateful to Dr. Gagan Gupta for accepting our invitation. So to propose the vote of thanks, I would invite Rachel to give the formal vote of thanks.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Okay, ma'am, I'll start. It's my privilege to propose a vote of thanks for SXI Maths Webinar Series 9, 2021. On behalf of SXI Manager, Father Blaise D'Souza, Principal Dr. Sosama Samuel, Staff in Charge, Dr. Vinnie Sebastian, I extend a hearty vote of thanks to our resource person for the day, Dr. Gagan Gupta, who spared time from his busiest schedule for this webinar. Today, we have been privileged and had this amazing opportunity to hear your session on talking science to mathematics person. Thank you, sir, for relating everything in science to mathematics and vice versa. The activities conducted by you helped us to get a concrete idea on the concept. I'm sure all this information will help us immensely in our respective field. So thank you, sir, once again. Next, I would specially like to thank our manager, Father Blaise D'Souza, and Principal Dr. Sosama Samuel for allowing us to continue with Maths Webinar Series 9. I would like to thank and appreciate our staff in charge of Mathematics Pedagogy Unit, Dr. Vinnie Sebastian, for motivating and encouraging us to continue with this webinar series. My heartfelt gratitude to our student coordinators, Alsona, Riesel, Clarice, Rachel, Vaseem, and Nisha, for being the strong team behind the curtain and providing technical support. And last but not the least, a big thank you to all the participants for your presence. Without each and every one of you on Zoom and YouTube, this event wouldn't be successful. We hope that you are taking back something with you from today's session. So once again, thank you for making this event a success with your enthusiastic participation. With this, I end my vote of thanks. There are some instructions regarding the feedback form. We will be posting the feedback form link when the session will come to an end. The link is already posted in the chat box of Zoom and YouTube. Please note later on, no link will be posted in the WhatsApp chat. Feedback form will be open only up to 7:30 p.m. While filling the form, make sure that you have entered the correct email address. If you do not get the certificate, wait for some time and check your spam folder. Even after that, you do not get the certificate, then you can contact any of the student coordinators before 7:30 p.m. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. And this is the conclusion of the season one mathematics webinar series. We will continue after a break. The mathematics webinar series will continue after 1 or 2 months. So till then, you can message us on our email ID, mathslearning@sxie.in, mathslearning@sxie.in. And the YouTube channel is also called Mathematics Learning. So teachers, you all can keep in touch with us till we meet again. So Samma ma'am or Father Blaze, would you all want to say something before we close the meeting? So Samma ma'am.
I would like to say that the session was very informative, and sir could bring many examples and which was connecting science and maths. Overall, it was very informative, sir. I think we want Dr. Gagan sir's continuous involvement in the future also. Yeah, because sir is a part of NCERT curriculum framework. So, sir, we are expecting your continuous involvement and help in all the dealings related with our syllabus and our curriculum construction, etc. Thank you very much, sir.
I would like to be a part of your physics activities as well, if you have.
Which activity, sir?
Physics.
Okay, sir. Okay.
I am a student of physics.
We'll speak to our science pedagogy, sir. And Vinnie madam is the mathematics pedagogy.
I am thankful that you have given me a chance to interact with you. And we run another platform, Vinnie ji is knowing, through which we are trying to trying to give the platform to the teachers for sharing their innovations, for sharing their ideas. So if any one of you wants to speak on our forum, most welcome.
Okay,
most welcome.
So you have given your email ID,
you know, yes, Vinnie ji is having everything with
me. We will be in touch with you, sir.
Sure, most welcome. In fact, we are trying to give the platform to the young teachers or would-be teachers, so that because they do not get any platform. We are trying to provide them. And our forum is succeeding because now many experts are asking us to be a part of it.
Okay.
So it's in good hands now. It's working okay. It's good.
Through networking, we learn, no, sir?
Yes. Thank you.
Sure, definitely.
This is the power of Corona period.
Thank you so much from St. Xavier's Institute of Education. I am expressing the gratitude to you.
Thank you, ma'am. Can I leave, Vinnie ji?
Father Blaze, you want to say something or I'll end the meeting? Yes.
Yeah. No, I just wanted to make a quick comment, and that is, I have attended several of these webinars, not each and every one, and also I was very much intrigued by most of the inputs that were being given today by Dr. Gagan Gupta. What I would like to see happening is that teachers are able to bring the level of mathematical language and critical analysis to the level of the students, so that they are able to utilize it in their daily lives. There is often a dichotomy between what is happening in class and what is happening in the world around them. They perhaps need to learn this mathematical language and critical analysis of reality in different spheres, so that it becomes part of their daily lives. A critical mathematical and statistical analysis of things that are happening around. Otherwise, a lot of opinions that are expressed are purely speculative. I mean, you see something, you read something in the newspapers, and you come to conclusions which are not based on real statistical facts. This, I think, is important for our students to learn while they are in school already and be able to apply it to the reality around them. Critical analysis, statistical analysis, and to come up with factual information as to what is happening in the world around, whether it is the physical world, social world, economic world, in all these spheres. Otherwise, there is a lot of just, you know, vague knowledge that people have based on hearsay, on things that they see here and there. I would like to thank Dr. Gagan Gupta because he gave us an insight into this area of critical analysis. And I see that you all have done some surveys. And when I was looking at those surveys, see, we ourselves must be able to come to conclusions on the basis of those surveys. What are we going to do? If there are things that need to be tackled in the field of mathematics or science, or I would say statistics, that will make our students develop a more analytical and realistic understanding of what is happening around them in whatever world it is field, whether it is science, whether it is physics, chemistry, agriculture. You see, with all my years in the rural areas, this is one of the problems that I found. Unless we make science and mathematics reach down to the level of students in their daily lives, in their occupations, it remains something very theoretical. A student must be able to understand how to measure his own field. He must be able to understand how to measure the volume in his well, how much water he's using or needs to use. These are things which would make mathematics practical to students in their also use of the elements that are their resources, the natural resources that are there. So this is what I would like to see happening. Thank you very much, Dr. Gagan Gupta, and I would like to thank this mathematics group. I suppose after all this, we should be able to take it down to the level of students. And I would like to see more collaborative learning among students in class as well as outside class. Collaborative learning in the field of mathematics, not competitive learning so much. We are not here to defeat one another by marks and grades. We are here to be enriched by putting together all the potential that that students have and that we as teachers have. And I would like to see this happening. Thank you very much. That's all that I have to say.
Thank you, sir. So I will meet you whenever I happen to be in Mumbai.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Okay, sir.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, ma'am. And thank you.
Thanks.
So, ma'am, can I end the meeting?
Yeah, I think so. You can end the meeting.
Okay.